Hi, I'm Jim Hoskins.
And I'm Jason Seifer.
And you're watching The Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets, where we talk about all things web design, web development, and more.
In this episode, we'll be talking about making your website ready for Internet Explorer 10, mobile fonts, as well as CSS code smells. Nick Pettit is out this week due to a bizarre gardening accident.
So everybody talks about making mobile apps in HTML5, but how do you really make it feel native, especially on iOS?
I have no idea.
Well, we have the anatomy of making a native-feeling iOS app using HTML5 right here on Justin Vincent's blog.
Thanks, Justin.
It's actually really cool. It's not a lot of real technical stuff as far as code-wise, but it takes an app that he made, and it shows sort of the various components they use to make it feel like a native app. For instance, wrapping the HTML in PhoneGap to get rid of the browser Chrome, as well as some of the frameworks you use and some of the techniques like using FontFace for some nice fonts, CSS3 calculations and animations, and a lot of other cool techniques. So it goes through some of the screens and points out sort of the techniques that were used to make it feel really native, make it look really good, and be very responsive. So it's really cool to check out kind of some things that you may not sort of remember when trying to build an HTML5 app for an iOS device.
What's interesting is we talked about a project called FastClick on the last Treehouse Show, and there's an equivalent of that built into one of the JavaScript frameworks that he uses in his application.
It's pretty cool. It's a pretty common technique to fill, so a lot of different mobile frameworks actually implement that type of behavior. So it's really important to do, though, because otherwise it feels really laggy.
Shameless plug, go watch all of our previous episodes of the Treehouse Show. Next up, times are changing in the land of web design and web development, and there's a blog post over on the Amazed Saints Tech Journal, Changing Times for Web Developers, 6 Tips That You Should Read to Survive. The first tip, learn to write better JavaScript and CSS. I think maybe learning to build a fire would be a pretty good tip to survive, but I digress. Learn to write better JavaScript and CSS. That's always something that you're going to be needing to do in these changing times of web development. Familiarize yourself with a responsive framework. This is also a very good idea. Responsive is something that we talk about probably a little bit too much on this show. Another tip, he says, is to learn the most useful JavaScript MVC frameworks. And he has a list of 6 of them on here. You can also check out To-Do MVC for examples of building applications in all of these different frameworks. And then, as well as the usual, understand REST and HTTP, and understand HTML5 beyond the buzzword, and finally, optimize. For more information on all of those things, you can find the link to that in our show notes at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
So the short version of it is just keep learning everything?
Stay sharp.
Stay sharp. Well, I know a site that can keep you real sharp on all the latest web design, web development techniques.
What site is that?
I believe it's called teamtreehouse.com.
Oh.
Pretty cool site.
I'll have to check that out. Never heard of it.
So, you've heard of IE, Internet Explorer?
I have.
Remember when we always used to develop for it, and it was like, this site only works in IE?
That's what I refer to as the good old days.
Well, the good old days are gone, and now sites don't work in IE. And here's a nice blog on the Windows blog on how to make your WebKit-optimized sites work for Internet Explorer 10. Because now we're all so hopelessly dependent on the WebKit browser prefixes that all of a sudden we don't have browser standards anymore and WebKit's the new IE, or so they say. But it's actually a pretty good outline. Most of the tips are pretty common advice. It starts off pretty strong by including sort of the standard CSS in addition to the WebKit prefix CSS, because for some of the items, Internet Explorer only supports the standard, obviously not the WebKit prefix. But there are some other ones as well. A lot of them are pretty new to me. I haven't really developed for Internet Explorer, so there are some things where it's just like, I did not know you had to do that. And for instance, like the touch events, Microsoft implemented their own instead of like touch stars, like MS tap down. And so there's a lot more branching code that you have to do, but there's a lot of different tables from sort of the WebKit way of doing it to how to fix it to do both WebKit and Internet Explorer based interactions. So if you are looking to make your website work really well in Internet Explorer 10 and you want to optimize maybe for touch on the Surface tablets, really good resource to check out because it goes over everything.
This would also be a great resource to check out if you're going to build a library that abstracted this all away for us.
Oh, that'd be nice. Hopefully on the next episode of Treehouse.
Next up is our app review. Our app review this week is an app called Hammer. Hammer is actually a paid application, but this is a web development tool for web designers and web developers. This lets you build out static HTML sites really quickly. You don't have to worry about any server-side scripting languages, and it supports all of the different things that you're possibly used to, like SAS, HTML includes, paths, CoffeeScript, and a bunch of things like that. It's very simple to use. Here is a demo of it. Right up here, I created a project, and it shows you all of the different little assets that you have inside of the project. In one click, you can launch it inside of your text editor. Then you get access to the output inside of the build directory. And then you can even break it up into different includes for your header, footer, navigation, pretty much anything that you need inside of your project. So you can find this application over at hammerformac.com. Worth noting that Hammer is not sponsoring this show, shame on them, but it's still a pretty cool application, especially useful if you're getting started on building a new static website.
That's pretty cool.
I like it.
Yeah. So speaking of editors, colors are very important in your editor because you're looking at that thing all day, right?
It's like for syntax highlighting.
Yeah. And you don't want to go around and find all those different themes to find them. What if they're all in one place?
That would make my day.
Color schemes, this project has a whole bunch of them. I haven't even counted them.
Just, consider my day made.
I just kept scrolling and there's just so many themes.
They are really nice looking.
They are some very nice themes, different light ones, dark ones.
Maybe you're feeling like grunge today. Maybe you want a grungy green theme.
Something more futuristic, maybe?
Maybe you want something darker and orange. They got that.
You got pretty much a theme for every time of day, every mood, and every piece of code that you have.
1:30 p.m. on a Tuesday, use the Earth song theme. Why not?
That's good feng shui or good energy at 1:37, right?
Yeah.
So these are compatible with Sublime Text 2, TextMate, as well as Vim are added in there for all the color schemes. So it's a good set of schemes to check out, and you can install them all and just switch them to your heart's content.
Very nice. Next up, we have a project called EpicEditor, and its name is actually pretty correct. This is an embeddable JavaScript markdown editor. So if you are needing to write markdown, which I personally find that users enjoy more than, you know, using one of those WYSIWYG editors, gives you some formatting options. You can give it a preview, click right back to edit. And it's nice, you can actually go full screen, you know, saying, I'm writing markdown. And it'll request full screen privileges if you got them. And then you can actually get a preview on the right while you're writing your markup on the left. So kind of neat. I like it.
Well, that is really cool. I love markdown. It's my preferred way of writing anything, my blog or really just anything I write. I write in markdown first and then
checks.
Convert it. Checks, yeah. I always have a little asterisk around my name to make it bold.
There you go.
Okay, so on mobile devices, guess which font is supported across iOS, Android, and Windows Phone 7?
Helvetica. Comic Sans.
Well, according to...
Papyrus.
No. According to Tinytype, nothing.
Nothing? That's terrible news.
So Tinytype is a compatibility table, or rather an incompatibility table, for built-in fonts on mobile platforms. So there's a lot of research done in here as to which fonts are built into which platform. And Android looks pretty sparse. Looks like only four of them. And even beyond that, there is no single font that spans across all three. But if you want to know which fonts are available on iOS, Android, or Windows Phone 7, Tinytype is a great table to look at. And he's trying to keep it up to date, so people are submitting updates if the information is incorrect. So pretty good resource to check out if you just need to know what fonts are available where.
That's both awesome and kind of concerning all at the same time.
Fonts are important.
Yeah, thanks for putting that together. So finally, we have an article called Code Smells in CSS. Very often when you're learning to program or, you know, code in any different language, it can be as useful to learn from the things that you are not supposed to do as much as from what you are supposed to do. So there is a great blog post here by Harry Roberts on different code smells that you might encounter when writing CSS. Now he goes through and he breaks down different things that you may not want to be doing and then shows how you probably do want to do it. Now, this is a really long article, so we're not going to go into everything on here, but it's definitely worth the read. You'll probably find some things that maybe you were doing that you probably shouldn't. So yeah, check that out. We'll have that link in the show notes as well. And that's about all we got for this episode. Jim, who are you on Twitter?
I am Jim R. Hoskins on Twitter.
And I am Jay Seifer. Thanks so much for tuning in to this episode of The Treehouse Show. For more information on anything we talked about, you can check out our show notes at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
This episode was brought to you by Treehouse, the best way to learn how to design and develop for the mobile and web. Check us out at teamtreehouse.com.
We'll see you next time.
If you'd like to see more advanced videos and tutorials like this one, go to teamtreehouse.com and start learning for free.